today. A few announcements that I would like to call your attention to. Oh, yeah. I need you to check your phone. Okay. In case you're losing track of time, as I am, today is the 24th. Our regular schedule, Tuesday, we have prayer meeting here at the church house, and then Tuesday evening, we're at the Windmill Winery over in Florence. You can join us for that. And in case you don't know what a windmill looks like, that's what it looks like. And in case you don't know where Florence is, just follow the road. Well, Dale and Hazel are back from their long adventure. God bless you. Glad to see you this morning. Appreciate you being here. And we're delighted to have Joyce and Ben back with us. They were with us last week. Wave Joyce and Ben. If you didn't meet them, be sure to meet them. And so we have a number of people from my family that are physical family that are here today. And most of them you have met. You met our son Nathan. And Tiffany will be coming and going with. Oh, there she is. Uh-oh. My grandson Noah's having a meltdown. No, he's not. Oh, and Ella. Hi, Ella. Hi. Oh, look, she smiles at me now. That's only happened in the last couple of weeks. We're just delighted that that they could be here. But I especially want to introduce you to my sister and brother-in-law. You'll get to know in a little bit. This is my younger sister, Laura, and her husband, Richard. Glad to have you guys with us today. They are actually in transit now, moving from Tucson. Richard recently got his doctorate in choral music from the University of Arizona and has taken over the music program at a university in Michigan. So they're moving to Michigan in about a week or so. But they saved time for us today. So we're going to enjoy having the time together. Delighted to have all of them here with us. So Friday, young people. Oh, by the way, everyone, if you didn't know, hey, come on in, guys. If you didn't know, we are having a potluck luncheon following over in the fellowship area, and there's plenty of food. So even if you didn't hear about it, it was kind of a sudden thing. We didn't decide until Wednesday that we wanted to do that. So don't worry about that. There's plenty of food, because we do have peanut butter and jelly sandwiches came from my house. You can tell my wife's been practicing grandma for some time, so peanut butter and jelly sandwiches are there, so yeehaw. One other I want to introduce, some of you have met another of our sons, David, stand up. He's been here before. And stand up, Stephen. Stephen, you can appreciate, this is my nephew. Recently came to work for us, all the way from Kansas. And some of you may have noticed he has been cleaning carpet and pews here at the church for us this week. We got the whole center section clean. And this week he'll be doing the outer ones too. So if you see a tall, skinny guy, you'll know it's not the pastor. But it is my nephew. So I appreciate having all of you here today. And of course, we're here today to honor the Lord and to worship him. And just delighted that you would choose to take time out of your schedule. Some of you probably didn't get to meet Harold and Katie. They were here on High Attendance Day and the Testimony Day. But would you guys wave? Harold and Katie have the Windmill Winery. Most Sundays they're busy with events, but they don't have a wedding today. And so they came to join us today, and we're just delighted.
We heard there was food.
You heard there was food.
I brought you peanut butter and jelly.
Yes. So those of you who didn't get to meet Harold and Katie when we had the crowd back at Easter time, be sure to get to meet them and our fellowship time back there. So now we're going to turn our attention to just worshiping the Lord and singing some songs together. My wife's going to come help me. Yes? Okay. Wonderful. And the very first song is one that Linda Salerno introduced us to a couple of weeks ago. She's going to sing it through for us one time first, and then we'll all chime in and join in singing. The words will be up here for you. So. Yeah, we'll get over there. Yeah, if you'll minimize that, it's down at the bottom then.
Oh, you're good?
Find it. It's a purple one. There we go, from the beginning.
Okay, can you hear me all right? Okay. All right, so this song is called You're Not Alone, and it is just exactly that. It's a testimony that we are not alone, we're never forsaken, no matter what you're going through. So read the words to the song as I sing it through one time, and then I guess we're going to all do it together, correct? Okay.
Okay.
this, learn it as you can along the way. Today, Lord. And anyone who's been battling that intimidation of the enemy to say we're by ourselves, we're alone in the trials and difficulties we face, Lord, it's a lie. Because if we'll reach out to you, you will come running to meet us. Thank you, Lord. We bless you today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now we're going to sing Dwelling Places. Let's stand for this chorus as we sing together. We've been learning this over the last few weeks. Let's just get our focus on the Lord and worship the Lord in these moments together.
Yeah.
people that have come, receive our attempts to worship you today, Lord. We do love you, and our deeds and our words and our actions will prove that love. We bless you and thank you today in Jesus' name. Amen. Bless the Lord. Thank you. You may be seated. Now, Richard and Laura, my sister and brother-in-law, are going to come and lead us in some singing together. And as they do that, we have a special treat today because I get the privilege of baptizing my grandson, Caleb, today. So Caleb and I are going to go and prepare, and Richard and Laura will come and lead us in.
What a blessing to be with you today. Would you take a hymnal and let's sing My Jesus, I Love Thee, but I'm not sure what the number is. Let's see. So it looks like 210. Let's go there and see if that's the one. 210. My Jesus, I Love Thee. My Jesus, I
Which is actually the biblical form of baptism, symbolizing the washing away of those sins, which we need sometimes those visible pictures of that. But there are a couple of things that baptism is teaching. One is that Caleb's coming today saying, I believe that Jesus is God's Son. He died and was buried, and He rose again on the third day. What a wonderful testimony that is. For many years baptizing people, I thought that was the main message of baptism. Although obviously there is no salvation for us apart from what Jesus did in shedding his blood and dying on the cross and being resurrected. But there's a second message that's being preached by baptism that I didn't know for many years. Baptized scores and scores of people. Baptism is a picture of our walk with God. And if we're going to walk with God, we must die to our selfish, sinful nature that we've inherited and allow Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit to come alive in us. We have to have the death to flesh and to be born all over again in the image of Jesus. And baptism is a picture of that. And so, Caleb Lester, do you believe Jesus Christ is God's only Son, the Savior of your world, and your Savior living in your heart right now?
Yes, I do.
Then in obedience to the command of the Lord Jesus Christ, upon this your public confession of faith in Him, I baptize you, my little brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Jesus by baptism, raised to walk in newness of life.
Amen. Amen. Exciting. Would you take the hymnal once again? Let's go to number 4. To God be the glory. Let's stand together and sing celebration of Caleb's baptism. God be the glory. To God be the glory. Great things He hath done. So gather together, we can worship your name. We can gather together with folks that are seeking you. Lord, we give you this time. We give you our lives, our hearts. And Lord, we give you back what you've given us in terms of offering. We ask that you take it and multiply it, use it for your glory. Thank you for all that you've given us in your precious name. Amen. Seen the sunset on the day
glow of the sunrise when the tomb was open wide. Would I have known you? Could I have seen that you were more than just a man? You were Lord and King. But now I know you, and I can see that you
It's just a pleasure to be with you guys and to worship with you today. And when Rick said come and with Laura and do about 20 minutes of music or so, I said, well, what are some of the songs that you want to do? What are some of the hymns? What are some of the things you want me to sing and that you want us to sing as a congregation? And so we put together some things. So the pieces that we're about to do, you could probably list as some of Rick's favorite hits, okay? So through the years, all right? So the one that I just sang is an old piece that I've been singing, I don't know, how many, 20 years, 25 years?
It's been more than that.
Has it been more than that?
35.
When did it come out? This thing was 1981, okay, 1981. And I started singing that probably in 81, sang it for Rick, and he's like, oh man, every time you come near me, will you sing that song? So anyway, so we get that a lot. But some of these as well. Let's sing together. We've come into his house. Let's join together and sing. We should have there we go.
Come
We have come into this house and gathered in His name to worship You. We have come into this house and gathered in His name to worship Him. We have come into this house and gathered in His name and worship Christ the Lord. Worship Him.
Close our eyes and let's make it a personal thing. You can open them to look at the words every now and then, but we've come into Your house. Let's sing it right to the Lord.
We have come into Your house and gathered in Your name to worship You. We have come into Your house and gathered in Your name to worship You. We have come into Your house and gathered in Your name to worship Christ the Lord. Worship You, Jesus Christ the
You may know these, or if you don't, you can get familiar with these. But some of these are oldies but goodies. This is the day. What's the matter? We got to stand up for this. Okay, this one. Stand up.
So you got one more. There we go. Ready.
This is my commandment, that you love one another, that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another, joy may be full. That your joy. My commandment, that you love one another, that your joy.
Now He's the King. He is the King.
He is the King of Lords. He is the Lord of Lords. His name is Jesus. 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 Jesus.
He's the King.
He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. His name is Jesus. 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 Oh. He is the King.
And back to
to "This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made."
Amen. Would you be seated? Amen. It's always a pleasure to be with my mother-in-law. You know, there are a lot of mother-in-law jokes, but I have nothing but love and respect for my mother-in-law, and for all these years she's put up with me, and she's put up with our part of the family as well. So Romaine, come and bless us with your lovely voice. Favorites from way back, and he said, "You know, we really, really love to teach this to the congregation this morning. And so maybe you've done it once or twice. I don't know, but it might be new to you. But let's learn it together here."
Here I am waiting. knees. May I know Jesus more and more. Come live in me all my life. Take over. Come breathe in me and I will rise on eagle's wings. Come live in me all my life. Take over. Come breathe in me and I will rise on eagle's wings.
Here I am waiting.
Here I am waiting, abide in me, I pray. Here I am longing for you. Hide me in your love, bring me to my knees. May I know Jesus more and more. Come live in me all my life. Take over. Come breathe in me and I will rise on eagle's wings. Come live in me all my life. Take over. Come breathe in me and I will rise on eagle's wings. I will rise on eagle's wings.
Bless
you. Just before Rick comes to bring the word from the Lord, we shall behold. The sky shall unfold, preparing his entrance. The stars will applaud him with thunders of sweet light of his eyes shall enhance those awaiting, and we shall behold him then face to face. Behold him, face
angels shall sound, the shout of his coming, the sleeping will rise from their slumber.
Richard and I were kind of kids when we worked together at the First Southern Baptist Church in Mesa back 40 years ago. We shall behold him, and you know, I want you to know that that I believe that the Bible is absolutely right on track when we will behold him. Not only on that day will I see my dad again. My brother Richard Greer, that was taken from us the week of his 28th birthday. My baby brother Caleb, that died on the same day 23 years later at age 44. Stephen's father, Stephen. We're going to see Caleb. We always do, Miss Caleb. But you know, when you're in the military, they make you use your first name whether you like it or not. So people at Wells Fargo headquarters know him as Rod, where he's working for 15 years, but he'll always be Caleb to us. And we're going to see Ed instead. And how many people that you know that have gone on before us, your parents, your siblings, for some of you, tragically, your children have been taken from you. You're good to see. My wife had another little sister. Died at birth, buried down in Tucson. Jennifer, we're going to see her. We shall behold him. And the sleeping will rise. We'll see him on that day. So these are not tears of sadness, but joy today for me. And I know that the Lord has touched you as well today. And we could just go eat right now, couldn't we? But my mom says, I didn't drive all the way from Tucson just for music. You got to do your part too. And for Truth in Advertising, we're going to start at the verse that's listed on the sign out there this week. Once again, thank you, Elizabeth. Yeah, appreciate you guys doing that. John chapter 5. John chapter 5, and we quote part of one of the verses there. We shall behold him. We shall behold him. We're going to behold him today on the pages of this book that are the record of the Word. Jesus Christ is the living Word. We are reading the record of the Word. And it's this Word implanted in the soil of our hearts that will transform us into His glorified image on that day. And in the meantime, this Word will transform us into His image so that Jesus Christ, by His Holy Spirit, can live through your personality and in your body and in your life circumstances every moment of every day with you. John chapter 5 is quite an extraordinary passage of Scripture. You're going to find some books and a lot of commentaries writing to explain some things away that we find here in John chapter 5. And naturally, that would be one of my favorite verses. Richard, I do have to say, I didn't mention your dad. We're going to see your dad on that day. Richard's dad was president at Grand Canyon University when Lynn and I met and where we went to school. And he died at a very young age, looks very, very young now. I have a heart attack right in the gymnasium sitting next to my brother. My brother actually gave him CPR. We're going to see him. And I'll never forget the college choir singing, "If I Be Lifted Up, I'll Draw All Men to Me." At the memorial service, the mayor of Phoenix and a lot of dignitaries came because Richard's dad, Dr. William Hensey, was so well respected in Phoenix and loved by the community, and did a lot of good things with Boy Scouts as well as things with the college and through his church, First Southern Baptist Church in Phoenix. So there are too many to name, and the list on the other side gets to be more and more. That makes me have a lot of appeal about that life that's on the other side. Meanwhile, Jesus in John chapter 5 says in verse 1, "After these things there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the Sheep Gate a pool which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having five porticos." Some of yours say Bethsaida, depending on the translation that you're reading there. "In these lay a multitude of those who were sick, blind, lame, and withered." And stop right there. Because in the middle of this verse, I have a bracket and a little margin note. In this edition of the New American Standard Translation, over here on the side, it says that many manuscripts don't contain the remainder of verse 3 nor verse 4. So does this verse and a half actually belong in the Scripture, or was it something that was added later? Was it a mistake? Since there are, you remember how many manuscripts more than 1,000 years old are extant, are still in existence today that can be studied by scholars, and occasionally some of us tourists go by and look at them. But do you know how many manuscripts more than 1,000 years old are used to translate the so-called New Testament Scriptures? It's more than 24,600. I didn't mean 2,400. 24,600 manuscripts, more than 1,000 years old, some of them 1,900 years old, from which these words that we're reading here are preserved and are given to us in a form simple for us to read from. It doesn't tell me here, out of the, I don't know how many records of the Gospel of John, let's say it's 500 Gospels of John or 1,000, I don't know if that means 200 don't have it or if it's 10 out of 100, I don't know how many. So when I look at this, and I'm coming to it with intellectual honesty, I don't know whether this belongs in the Bible or not. So here's what we do. If we're not sure if it belongs in here, let's read it without it in there. And let's see if it makes sense. Okay, so here we are in verse 3. "In these lay a multitude of those who were sick, blind, lame, and withered." Verse 5. "And a certain man was there who'd been 38 years in his sickness." Wow, that's a long time to have a sickness. "And when Jesus saw him lying there, knew that it had already been a long time in that condition, he said to him, 'Do you wish to get well?'" That was the question we posed that was on the sign out front. By the way, some of you have heard that at memorial service recently, there was a devout Catholic lady who goes, I think, to Superior, to church, and she said, she told me, you know, your church is in our Catholic services almost every week. And I went, say what? Playing video? What? You know what? I said, no. He said, the priest always reads what's on your sign at Queen Valley, and frequently he talks about it in our services. So there's the praise the Lord for that. Do you wish to get well? Good question. And the sick man answered, Sir, I have no man to put me in the pool when the water stirred up, but while I'm coming down, another steps down before me. Hey, buddy, you've been sick for 38 years. Anybody home? He said, do you wish to get well? And now you're talking about... He said, I have no man to put me in the pool, and the water stirred up, and while I'm coming down, someone steps in before me. Hello? Chunk fell out of the ceiling? This guy's nuts! Jesus said, do you wish to get well? He said, sir, there's no one to put me in the pool. When the water stirred up, somebody always gets down there before me. Yeah, but do you wish to get well? That doesn't make any sense at all. How about we read that verse and a half that some manuscripts apparently don't have in it, and let's see if it will enlighten us a little bit. Verse 3, in these lay a multitude of those who were sick, blind, lame, and withered, waiting for the moving of the waters. For an angel of the Lord went down at certain seasons into the pool and stirred up the water. Whoever then first, after the stirring up of the water, stepped in, was made well from whatever disease with which he was afflicted. And a certain man was there, been 38 years in sickness. Jesus saw him lying there and said, you've been in that condition a long time. He said, do you wish to get well? And said, sir, I have no man to put me in the pool. And the water stirred up while I'm coming down, another steps down before me. Maybe this guy wasn't nuts. Maybe that verse and a half that's in question maybe belongs there. I'm just going to leave it in my Bible, but I want to go further with you about that. Okay? Hold on. This seems a little nuts, doesn't it? Now come on, think about it. God sends an angel down to a pool in the middle of Jerusalem. He stirs up the water, and the first person that gets in the water gets healed. I'm a little bit skeptical about that. I might have to see this myself. And then if I see it myself, I might have to question the guy that gets well and say, were you really sick in the first place? Or are you like some of these shysters out there faking healings and things, putting people in wheelchairs who are not wheelchair bound, and then acting like, oh gosh, God healed them, they come up out of the wheelchair. By the way, there have been people who've been raised up out of wheelchairs that have been healed, but there have also been a lot of fakes. I want nothing to do with the fake. I want the real thing. And so, I look at this and I say, this is rather bizarre. Is there any rational explanation as to why God would do something so extraordinary and so bizarre such as this? And I believe there's a perfect explanation, because I grew up in 20th century American churches. You see, many of us grew up in churches that denied that God did miracles or healings anymore. But do you know that one of the Hebrew names for God is healer? I, the Lord, am your healer. God said to the children of Israel, I will not put on you any of the diseases of Egypt of which you have known, one place he says. I will not put those harmful diseases of Egypt on you. I'll lay it on all the people that hate you. God said, I, the Lord, am your healer. And one place he says, and he sent his word and healed them. Oh, by the way, we have the record of the word. Who is the word? Jesus. That verse really says, and he sent Jesus to heal them. He sent his word to heal them. So here God, part of what he does for his people is he does the supernatural. He does that which cannot be explained physiologically in healing sick people and making people well that seek after him. But all the church leaders, much like American Christianity, have said, no. We have to explain everything physiologically and scientifically, or we're not going to believe it, so God doesn't do that anymore. And yet God, part of his nature, is healing his people. He takes pleasure in that. He takes joy in that. But the whole church at the time of Jesus had been convinced that all the healing stopped back with Elijah and Elisha. that all that healing stopped years ago. God doesn't do that anymore. We're in a different dispensation. And they write tons and tons of books to explain how God doesn't do anymore what he used to do. And yet God, part of his nature, is to heal and to do the supernatural for those that love him and that are serving. And so I can just see the scene. You know, the Bible, there are a couple places the Bible describes the throne room of God the Father. It's interesting, there's always a division. It says, it talks about those on his right and those on his left. And we are privy to God having conversation with the host of heaven that are before him. And I have a feeling that there was a conversation like this one day. He said, all the religious leaders are telling my people that I don't heal anymore and they're full of sickness and disease. I want to do something that will be a testimony against their unbelief and their false teaching, and I'm going to put it right smack dab in the religious capital of the world. I'm going to put it right in Jerusalem. So here's what I'm going to do. Come here, angel. I want you to go down and stir up this water down here. And after you stir the water up, any sick person that gets in is going to get healed. And the sick person gets in, boom, they get well. How are the religious leaders going to explain that away? They'll have a hard time. They'll have a hard time explaining that. How can people explain, Joyce, that when I first met you, you're walking with a walker and somebody told me that you had to be in a wheelchair sometimes and we pray for you and then you're walking with a cane and now you walk normally. How do you explain that? You know, explain it, would you? I'm intentionally saying that. I know it's explain, but I didn't explain it. I'm just throwing that out there because, you know, and here Jody is over here. She was running stuff back there. She's getting strength in her right side and she can wiggle her toes and she can jump. And she, for 26 years, her whole life, she's never been able to do that before. Explain that. You see, God puts things around us to confound those who think they have figured him out. Yeah, but really, this is pretty bizarre. Here's another evidence in this passage that tells me why the sick people really got well. Think about the last time you were really sick. Maybe that's today. Yeah. Pat's back there pointing at Dorothy. My neck's getting hot. My neck's getting hot. And God removed the blockage and she didn't have to have surgery on her carotid artery. And we just asked God to touch her. And he did. See, how to explain it. Notice this now. When you were the last time you were really sick, and in my case, we were working on a fire job in Kearney several years ago, and I did a very foolish thing. I knew better than to do this. But a lot of times when we have a terrible job to do in the business we were involved in and still are to some degree, I'll take on the worst thing. And these two bathrooms in this house that had a fire were really bad. And I know when you're dealing with cleaning products, you need good ventilation. And the ventilation wasn't good enough. And I got chemical poisoning. It did some strange things to my body. I was flat on my back, sicker than a dog for about 4 days. Couldn't hold anything down. I won't go into the gory details, but anyway, needless to say, I was really sick. If you had come along to me and said, hey, Rick, over at Queen Valley, no, you know that winery over at Florence? They've got a couple of ponds. There's not much water to be found here, except at the swimming pool. There's a pond. If you will go over there, if the water stirs up and you get in first, you can get well. Now, here I am. If I, you know, eat anything, I puke my guts out. I'm laying on the couch, and you say to me, I want you to go with me over to the windmill, to the pond there, because we hear an angel stirs up that water, and if you get in first, you'll get well. And I'd look at you and say, not happening. The last thing that I want to do is be around a bunch of sick people, and the other last thing I want to do is to have to travel and move around. I want you to notice that the scripture says in verse 3, by the way, that doesn't have a margin note, in verse 3 it says, in these, this pool of Bethesda, lay a multitude of those who were sick, blind, lame, and withered. Would the sick people continue to hang out by this pond if there was just a rumor somebody might get well? I don't think they would be there. You know why they were there? Why there was a multitude of them there? And why when Jesus said, you wish to get well, the man said, I don't have anybody help me get in the water. Somebody gets in there before me. They get healed and I don't. They were there because people were getting healed. That's exactly why. And I believe that God was giving a testimony against the false teaching that was going on among his people and among the religious leaders in that day, because he was still a God who heals. He said to the man, "Do you wish to get well?" And he said, "No, there's nobody. Put me in the water." And Jesus, in essence, in verse 8 says, "I'll take care of it. You don't even have to get in the water. Rise, take up your pallet, and walk."
What is that?
Take up your pallet, walk. And immediately the man became well, and he took up his pallet and began to walk. Do you know what happens if you lie in a hospital bed for several days? There's a few of you who have experienced that this last year. Hi, nice to see you again. Last time I saw you, you were in the hospital. I'm glad to see you and Sam here today. God bless you guys. Glad you're back. But see, just a couple of days of lying there, and your muscles get weaker. And your tendons and ligaments tend to stiffen up a little. I find that more and more so the longer I'm around here. I don't mean Queen Valley, I mean here on this planet. The longer I'm around this world, here I find that to be true. Here's a guy who has not been well for 38 years. He's got atrophied muscles, he's got weakness in his tendons and ligaments, his bones are probably stiff, his joints probably don't work too well. It's not specified what his illness was, but he obviously had some mobility issues because he couldn't get to the water fast enough when it would get stirred up. And so Jesus says, "Take up your pallet and walk," and immediately, this isn't just a healing. This is actually astoundingly miraculous, that strength comes into his body, power into his muscles and bones, and strength into his blood vessels, tendons, ligaments, and he gets up and he moves. Every bit of his body has been transformed simply at the statement of Jesus, "Take up your pallet and walk." You would think, now, a guy's been sick 38 years. To see him walking normally, wow! What is this? Everybody's going to rejoice, right? Now it was the Sabbath on that day, verse 9. Therefore the Jews were saying to him who was cured, "Hey, it's a Sabbath. It's not permissible for you to carry your pallet." And I see him carrying his pallet, and he's all excited. He's moving. Probably doing like Joby did the other day on Wednesday night here, praying, jumping up and down. And they said, "Hey, you can't do that. Stop it. Put that pallet down. I've been sick 38 years. You couldn't have cared less. The man who came along told me to pick up my pallet. I think I'm going to obey him instead of obeying you." And he just kept right on. And they said, "Who is the man," verse 12, "who said, take up your pallet and walk?" And he who was healed didn't know who it was. No, oh, no, wait a minute. I thought if God's going to heal you, you have to be some kind of super saint. Big S on the chest. Super saint. I've got perfect attendance for the last 5 years. I'm reading the Bible through. I've got all of this knowledge and wisdom. Super saint, God heals me. No, this man didn't even know who Jesus was. I have had that experience a couple of times. Praying for people that we're kind of ambivalent about, well, you know, is God real? Is Jesus Son of God? I don't know. You pray for sick people like that and they get well. Guess what? They get a big shock and awakening to find out how powerful God is. Norm's over here nodding his head and smiling because he's had that happen as a chaplain over in Casa Grande. He's prayed for many sick people. Got up and got well. And God just confirmed the truth of who Jesus was. The man didn't know who it was. Verse 14, afterward Jesus found him in the temple and he said to him, "Behold, you've become well. Do not sin anymore so that nothing worse may befall you." In our study about physical healing, we know of at least 9 causes for physical sickness. If you read this passage and you want to simply say anytime somebody is sick it's because of sin, you would be in error. Because that's not always the case. But if you are sick and it's because of sin, guess what? If you'll repent, we can pray for you and God will heal you. But you can repent until the cows come home, and if the sickness didn't come on you because of that, Well, that isn't going to solve your physical problem. In this man's case, he had been 38 years in the sickness because of personal sin. And Jesus said, don't do that anymore. Walk the right way. You become well. I can almost hear a smile in the voice of Jesus. Behold, you become well. Although when God talks, it's, I will smite thee. I have my club. One more step, and I'll crush you. But listen to the voice of Jesus. Behold, you've become well. I can hear him smiling in those words. He's rejoicing. And then he said, because this came on you because of sin, don't sin anymore so that nothing worse may befall you. And the man went away and told the Jews, Jesus is the one who made me well. And for this reason, the Jews were persecuting Jesus because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. Some of us erroneously assume that Jesus was breaking the Sabbath. Let me tell you, Jesus explicitly says in Matthew chapter 7, don't even think that I came to destroy the law of the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. And then he went on from there and said, and anyone that nullifies one of these commandments of mine will be least in the kingdom, but he that teaches and does them will be great in my Father's kingdom. So what was the problem then? It was their rules that men had made up about the Sabbath. That was never God's commandment about the Sabbath. And of course, Jesus made other comments about the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath, and some things like that. But it's interesting to me what Jesus goes on to say. This will give you something to think about. You know, she's just practicing her luster voice back there. That's all. Usually the luster women, they don't get loud like I do. They get loud making beautiful music and everybody smiles. When I get loud, people are going. I was always jealous, Richard, of the singers. They come up here and bellow it out. And I get up here and I bellow out what I have to say. And people are like, so she's working on that set of lungs back there. Listen to what Jesus said. My Father is working until now, and I myself am working. That's kind of what your mind should do. Whoa! If you get what this says. So you heard about God resting. God hasn't rested yet, is what Jesus is telling us in verse 17. Therefore, for this cause, the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, according to them, not according to God, but also calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. So today I want to ask you the question, do you wish to get well? You say, well, you know, I'm not sick. Oh, well, good. But are you spiritually sick? Are you emotionally sick? Do you wish to get well? God's in the business of making people well. We are eyewitnesses of the physical transformation we've seen in a number of people prayed for right here in these meetings, right back here where we're going to eat. We prayed for, that's where Dorothy got prayed for. Jody, I think that's where we prayed for you the first time, was back there, and God did this amazing, miraculous thing. But he's been doing a bunch more than that. He's been working on people's spirit and soul, restoring people's minds. While we were in Michigan the week before last, teaching out there, we prayed for some who were battling mentally and emotionally as well as people physically. And we look forward to hearing good reports of their progress after. I'm here to tell you that God is in the people business, and if you wish to get well, you can come to him. I was going to read two more passages, but I'm just going to refer you to them. One example is King Asa. Asa became diseased in his feet because he had sinned, and God sent a prophet and said, because of what you've done as a king, you haven't been godly, you haven't followed what I said to do, from now on you're going to have wars. And he got mad at the messenger, throws him in jail, and he gets diseased in his feet. And the Bible says, even though his disease was severe, he did not seek the Lord, but the physicians, and so he died. That's in 2 Chronicles 16. We'll look at it another time, but I just want to refer you to that. But there's a contrast to that, and that's in 2 Kings 20. In 2 Kings 20, there's another king, King Hezekiah, who's gotten an infection. The prophet Isaiah sent and says, God said, go tell him, get his house in order, you're going to die. And Hezekiah did the opposite of Asa. Asa hardened his heart, got mad at God, shook his fist at God. Hezekiah rolls over on his sick bed, his face to the wall, and he begins to weep and to cry out to God. And he says, God, remember how I've tried to be faithful to you and I've done these things for you. And he repented. And before Isaiah got out of the palace, God sent him back and said, I'll give you 15 more years. Asa was not willing to be well. I know because of what God did for Hezekiah, Asa could have been healed. He didn't have to die in the 41st year of his reign, except his own stubborn hard-heartedness caused his death. When God says, do you wish to get well? The question is, are you willing to meet the conditions so that you can become well? Do you wish to get well? You know, some people glory in their sickness, and we've had a couple of people testifying their own experience. Well, do I pray about it? But you know, if I get healed and I don't have this problem anymore, then I won't have people feeling sorry for me. You know, there are people that like that kind of attention. Let me tell you, that's not where God wants His people to walk. And so I encourage you to examine that question, do you wish to become well? If you do, I'm here to tell you in the name of Jesus Christ that you can be well by the power of God if you'll turn to Him and seek Him. If you'll meet His conditions, which means, by the way, humbling yourself, acknowledging your sinfulness and your need, as Caleb demonstrated for us today, to die to self and let Jesus Christ come alive in you. But if you're not willing to humble yourself and admit that you need help, then you can be like Asa and stay in your sickness until it consumes you. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, today we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth that we have sung in worship songs and hymns. And Lord, for the truth that transforms us as your word, the seed of your word, gets implanted in the soil of our heart. Lord, today, thank you for the testimony of young Caleb, saying he believes in Jesus, and he demonstrated it just Jesus as you said to do, although you were about 20 years older than Caleb is today. Lord, bless him and be with him on his adventure of learning to walk with you. Help him to learn how to obey his parents and grandparents and those around him to care for him, because that's the primary commandment that you've given him. Lord, today we've seen, we've heard, we've taken in, we've participated in glorifying you. Lord, today the question for us is, do you wish to get well? For some of us, that means letting go of some things in our lives, some things that are not pleasing to you. For some of us, it means forgiving people who've harmed us deeply. Lord, you said if we're not willing to forgive those who've wronged us, then you cannot forgive us for our sin against you. So Lord, in these moments right now, I just ask as you touch your hearts, maybe there's some that need to receive Jesus or need to publicly confess Him. You said if we'll confess you before men, then you'll confess us before the Father and all the angels in heaven. And today is an opportune time for that. So while the music is being played, if you need prayer today, or if you wish to get well today and need prayer, just come and be seated on the front row here. And at the conclusion of our service in a few moments, some of us will be happy to come and pray with you, and lay hands on you, anoint you with oil in the name of Jesus, and ask the Lord Jesus Christ to heal you. In these moments as we wait, just come and be seated here. Thank you, Lord. Praise you. Bless you. Anyone else? Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Bless your name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Would you stand with me just for a moment, and folks, stay seated on the front row here. And let's just sing that chorus together. Lovely are your dwelling places. The going to continue. Some of you that feel led will come and pray with these who are requesting prayer this morning. For everyone else, in a few minutes, we'll convene in the fellowship area in the back. Even if you didn't bring food, you're like, oh, I didn't bring it. That's right, the Lord's prepared for you, okay? You're welcome to stay with us. Be sure to meet our kids and our family and welcome back those who've been gone. And also be sure you meet our daughter-in-law's mom, Louise, is here. She watches our grandkids every day. We're so grateful God's got Louise in their life. And be sure to greet those around you. Meet Harold and Katie, those of you who didn't get a chance to meet them before. We're going to have just a prayerful time here for these folks right now. If you insist on going home, God bless you on your way, but you're welcome to stay, and we'll have a time of fellowship in just a few minutes here. Turn around and introduce yourself to someone nearby.